Good morning. So today we have the topic of human resource planning. Now, you all know what planning is, right? Yes or no? Tell me what is planning. Planning is planning. What is planning? Tell me again. Making schedules in advance. So, something into the future, advance, isn't it? You look into the future and make schedule. Can you give me an example?
Plan how to study for exam.
What would be that plan?
What to study and when to study.
Yes. So, what to study and when to study. Okay. So, then some of the definitions which have been given for planning are here. Human resource planning, for short we call it HRP, is a process by which an organization strikes a balance between human resources required on the one hand and acquired on the other hand in the organization. So, there are two distinct steps. First step is to estimate how much you require. Second step is then you acquire what is estimated, and it is like a balance sheet. You have to strike a balance. If you want a good plan, right, the good plan will only have the first component, right, and the second part of the planning definition, that is acquiring, will be done by what we call recruitment and selection. So, you plan, see, one definition says that is the whole thing, that is, it includes making the plan, that is what is required, and also the acquiring process. But most people look at it in two aspects. They say plan is making an estimate of what is required, and implementing that plan is basically the recruitment and the selection. Okay. Now, tell me, how do you think you will estimate what manpower you will require? Human resource planning. Human resource planning in organization.
What is the work requirement and what is the capability of manpower?
What is the work requirement? All right. What is the work requirement? So, we say what is the work requirement and how do you go about that work requirement? Whom do you ask or how do you make it out?
The sales department.
Sales department. So, you ask the sales department. Why do you ask the sales department? Because they are going to sell the product. Going to sell the product. So, what is the outcome, the output? When you ask that question to sales, what is the output you expect from the sales? What will sales tell you? They can sell, tell you how many products they will sell, isn't it? What else? We are talking HRP, human resource planning. Turnover means? Sales turnover means how much sales in rupees? Okay, sell and profit. How does it tell you how many people you will require? Isn't it? Can you think? You ask sales, we are following a line of thought where we say, what is your manpower required? You ask the sales department, he says. And why? He says, because they are going to sell the product. Then if you ask the sales department, how much manpower our organization requires, will they be able to tell you because they sell the product?
They will not directly tell this, the figure. You need the figure to estimate this.
I am at a loss to understand. Say I am in sales and you are in HR and you ask me, look, in our company, how many people will our company require next year? Say starting from 1st of April 2005 to 31st March 2006 next year. Now we are in the month of October. So I say that we require to make a plan now for next year. So the entire organization, the HRP is for the entire organization, is it not? So how will you as a HR manager go about making a plan for the manpower, the human resource? Not only by asking sales, right? You ask all departments, isn't it? Ask all departments, because each department will be able to estimate what will be the number of people that they require for them to carry out their planned work. For instance, if the sales department you ask that we are going to, if sales department you ask, what are they going to do? They are going to have an internal meeting. Then they will say, okay, next year, what is it that we are going to sell? Do we know our target? If they say, yes, we know our target, management has asked us to sell 20% more than last year, then do we require more manpower to sell 20% more or no? These are sort of questions they themselves will ask, right? They are the right people to tell you. Do you think they will require more manpower for 20% sales? No? Why not? Why not 20% more for 20%? Why?
Because they are also going to increase their efficiency.
They are going to increase their efficiency. Okay. So they have to debate among themselves, you know, in their own department, how much manpower we require. And that will depend on many factors. As he says, efficiency. If you increase efficiency, then you don't require a proportionate increase in the manpower in proportion to the amount of sales increase. Any other factors it will require? Job? Job scheduling. Now, what exactly do you mean by it? Job scheduling. You are a sales department. Imagine you are sitting in head office in Calcutta. You have 20 salesmen in your department. Now, you are saying you schedule your job. That is one of the factors that will depend on how much increase of manpower you require to make 20% more sales. So, scheduling, it may be correct what you are saying, but how?
It specifies the when to start the work and when to end.
We know that. You start work on 1st April and you end on 31st March. That is the period for which you have to increase. And normally they break it down. Every month what should be the sale? Your annual sale is X, okay, then the multi-sale is divided either by 12, or if there are some periods like puja, you have holidays, you say, all right, month of October if it is puja, then you cannot have 1/12 because there will be less sales. So, some other months you have to make it up. So, you make a plan of how much sales you get, all right, how many orders you get every month. But he is right, you know, scheduling. For instance, in Kolkata, you may be looking after the whole territory of West Bengal and Bihar, and Jharkhand and Assam and all the other northeastern states. So, if you regroup the territory which one person is going to cover, if you schedule it by regrouping the territory, After all, in order to sell, people have to travel, right? They have to travel to the places, meet the customer. So, if you regroup territory on a logical basis, which is clusters, say two salesmen will visit clients in one cluster, then you are saving a time of their travel. By saving time, you are throwing up more time for them to visit more clients, because travel time is saved. If they visit more clients, the chances are that they will be able to get more orders. That is the assumption. If you visit clients, you can get more orders. So, scheduling is one. Similarly, you are asking all the departments, and finally, what are you going to get from all departments? For the year, as we say, 2005-2006, we have sales department. What other departments do we have? Production department, then finance department, what else? Haji? Yes, your own department, let us say HR department itself, I will put it into bracket, because that you have to do yourself. Let us say R&D, okay? From each of these, you get a figure. So, this is a kind of process by which you will ask each department how much they are going to need, isn't it? So, HRP therefore, see this definition. HRP includes estimation of how many qualified people are necessary. Just now what we were discussing is a just a hash total, as we call it. We were not classifying into various qualifications or categories or skills. We are just saying total numbers, but that is not good enough finally. Finally, in real life, you have to get what categories of people you require. So, it includes estimation of how many qualified people are required or are necessary to carry out the assigned activities. How many people will be available, and what, if anything, must be done to ensure that personnel supply equals personnel demand at the appropriate time in the future. So, now you find another aspect here. How many people will be available? That also is important. You may find that you are able to find out how many you require, how many are necessary, but what if they are not available? How are you going to get them then? So, in the HR department, that is your responsibility. When people ask you that we require so many men of so much qualification, all right, it is your job then to fill those vacancies, isn't it? In IIT, whose job is it to fill vacancies for faculty members? Registrar's job? Dean of faculty and planning? Yeah. Head of department? Whose job is it? Do we have a planning process in IIT? There is a selection committee. There is an acquiring part of it, right? Acquire. What about human resource planning? Amongst human resource in our IIT, you may require faculty, there is one classification. Then staff and officers, that will be second classification. Third classification, maybe subordinate staff. So, there does not seem to be any HRP in this organization, educational, like you will have in normal companies. But in normal companies, every year there has to be what they call a budgeting exercise. Now, budgeting exercise does not only mean money budget, Normally, when we talk of budget, we think of money, right? So, in companies, in organization, profit-making companies, budget also means first the money budget and then the manpower, that is a personnel or human resource budget, and then also the capital budget. Now, here in educational institution, we do a capital budget, that is what is the infrastructure will require and what is the money will require. So, two types of money. One is money by which you make infrastructure, you create an asset, and the other is, that is called capital expense, because you create a lasting asset which can last for 10 years, 20 years. Other is revenue expenses, which is money which you spend and is gone. You buy some goods and services for it, but you don't create an asset. What are those expenses? Salary, yes. You are buying services, right, of people. But do you see a building or a pipeline or anything? You don't create an asset. So, that is revenue expenses. So, here we do the money budgeting. But here we don't seem to do the planning for faculty, because I don't think we see plans into the future. How many will retire this year, and therefore how much will be the expansion, what new departments will be expected to come, what kind of people will require. Today we have got 19 departments. If you make a 5-year plan and then break it up into 1-year plans thereafter, then you will find that you get closer and focus closer to, all right, if you are going to expand the student strength, you will require more people. If you are going to add new departments, you will also require more people, but there will be a difference. In new department, the type of people and the qualification may be different than expanding. If you expand mechanical engineering department, you will require mechanical engineering oriented faculty. But if you add a new department, all right, you will require more people, but of a different qualification. So, all these are elements of planning. So, unless you plan, what are you going to happen? If you don't know how many people will retire, how much faculty this year, next year, you won't be able to acquire that. So, who does that planning? Do you think we do no planning at all? Someone must be doing some planning. Where do you think the planning is done? It may be the HODs, that's right. So, instead of one centralized department, like here we are saying the HR department doing the planning for the entire company, there is another way of doing it also. There is a way of each individual department doing the planning and then sending that plan to a central person, who then takes certain actions. So, here probably what happens is you make a plan and send it to the dean, faculty and planning. But here the point I am making is, it's not as structured as in a profit making organization. It is less structured. For instance, Vinod Gupta School of Management may not be asked by anyone, dean, faculty of planning or any other authority, how many faculty you require or how many staff you require. So, I will have to then do it myself by whatever plan I have and then send that, but may not be in a form which is a consolidated form, may be in a form on case to case basis. That is, I want one faculty or I want two staff. Okay. So, HRP includes estimation of how many qualified people are necessary to carry out assigned activities, how many people will be available and what, if anything, must be done to ensure that personnel supply equals personnel demand at the appropriate time into the future. Now, depending on what systems you follow will depend on how efficient you are in correctly planning what will be your requirement in the future, and also efficiently acquiring. Efficient acquiring means what? That post should not be unfilled for long lengths of time, isn't it? That is one indicator of efficiency. Another indicator of efficiency is post should not be overfilled, that you have taken more than you have planned, because then you don't have the balance. So these are the kind of indicators by which you judge the efficiency of HRP, okay, whichever department does it. See another definition. Human resource planning is a process of determining and assuming that the organization will have an adequate number of qualified persons available at the proper times, performing jobs which meet the needs of the enterprise and which provide satisfaction to the individuals involved. Now, he has added another element, isn't it? The previous two definitions didn't talk of satisfaction to the individuals involved. This says that that also must be there to fulfill a good HR planning process. And why does it say that? Because we have been seeing in our study of human behavior and management that there is a focus which is two-pronged always. We talk of human satisfaction and we also talk of organizational effectiveness. That is, the performance should be good, but at the same time, people who are doing that performance, they should be happy and satisfied. We are always talking about these two. So, this definition has included the second aspect. So, this is more holistic. And then here you see is another definition. HRP is a process including forecasting, that means estimating, developing and controlling, by which a firm ensures that it has the right number of people at the right places at the right time, doing work for which they are economically most useful. So, yet another angle has been introduced here, the money part of it, economy most useful. Now, for it to be economically most useful, there are two ways, two elements or sub elements. One is you should deploy the right kind of qualifications for the right type of job. Because if you are underemploying someone, that is, he is too qualified and you are paying him because of his qualification and experience, but the work he is doing is below the level of work which he should be doing and can be doing, then it is economically a loss to the organization, right? And then the second is the quantity. If you have too many people, all right, then obviously you are wasting money, because in order to carry out the work you require less people, you are having too many people. So, this concept is introduced into the definition itself, economically most useful. And that raises an interesting question. In many good organizations, you know, in industry, the HR department has a right to question, when they ask each department, that how many people you will require and what types in the next year. They will get the reply, they will get a chart, so many people, and they can have the right for a justification. Why? Because the responsibility of seeing that it is economically, some companies have it, that there is economy that is on the HR department. And there are broad parameters by which you judge this economic use of manpower, very broad parameter. They are ratios basically for the total sales of the company. What was the manpower, all right, last year? What is it this year? And how much are they asking next year? And as we have discussed earlier, always there is an attempt that it should not be a linear growth. If you expand your business and your sales by 20%, you should have less than 20% manpower. That means the efficiency should be better. So that is a kind of total factor productivity ratio which you apply. Then you, that's not good enough sometimes, because the type of job may have changed, type of business may have changed. So you then look at it departmentally and see the ratio. How much did the department have in terms of manpower last year? What was their business? Can you think of any other ratio in order to judge economic use? One is the ratio of number of people to the amount of sales. Any other? Infrastructure, all right. How would you, what would be the ratio?
Number of persons for
number of machines. Okay. It may be because, say, you have introduced a new system that one man is tending two machines. Okay. Then you have increased the productivity. Any other way? Maybe the profit or the cost, if the department is a cost center, all right, then the amount of money that you have saved, okay, over the number of people. And so, depending on the type of business, the type of company and the type of industry, you can have different types of indicators to measure what is the efficiency. Another factor may be for measuring is how many direct people and how many indirect people. You understand the difference between direct and indirect? A direct person, okay, say in an organization here, you might call the faculty as a direct manpower, because the mission and the goal of the organization, what is the main, what is our business as an educational institution? To impart teaching. And those who are doing the teaching directly, they are called direct people, direct employees. But they can't do it unless they are supported by various other departments, isn't it? Administrative work has to be done. So they are equally valuable. They are also supporting the teaching, but not directly, doing it indirectly. So they are called indirect staff. Now, normally, we try to see that economic use of manpower is that there should be a high ratio of the direct employees to the indirect employees. That is where the efficiency comes. Clear, no? For instance, if you have 50% faculty and 50% support, that is 50 direct and 50 indirect on the one hand, and on the other hand, for the same number of students, let us say you are teaching, same exam, same number of courses, you got 50 direct and you only got 20 indirect. Isn't it more efficient? Huh? Because look at it the other way. That means if you are as efficient as that, with the same support staff, you can teach more students then in terms of support. So these are various ways of trying to see the economic.
Indirect?
Personnel, yes. They are always indirect because they are support.
But they are also doing very important activities.
Very important. That's why I made clear in the beginning that everyone is equally important.
Then why they will be treated as indirect, sir?
Because they directly don't do the job.
But that is very important activity which is direct.
But we are not saying that direct is more important than indirect. We are just defining the kind of work they do. Why are you assuming? You are assuming mentally,
yes, sir,
that indirect is less important. They are not. In certain industries, for instance, all right, a R&D department, if it is a knowledge-driven kind of company and industry, the R&D people are very important. But classification-wise, they will be indirect. Because they are not directly contributing to revenue in stream, money coming in. Who are those people? Those people are the sales and marketing, usually the sales. Marketing also is a semi-indirect because they are back office. They do advertising, all right, product costing and so on and so forth. But the sales people who go and actually get the order, they are called direct. And the production people who make the goods, you know, once the order comes, you have to produce it, either goods or service. And that production people, therefore, unless you produce, you can't give a bill, right? So they are called direct. But the indirect are very important. Not convinced? And it varies from industry to industry. As I just gave an example, certain industries which are market driven, like say fast moving consumer goods. If you read these newspapers, you have seen this term FMCG.
Yes.
What is FMCG? Fast moving consumer goods. Example, soaps, toiletries, healthcare items, alright, cosmetic items, foods, you know, jams, jellies. These are fast moving consumer goods. You also have another term, consumer durables. What are those goods? Consumer durables or white goods, they call it. White goods, etc., are durable. That is refrigerator, air conditioner, toaster, geysers, you know, in the bathroom. Those are not consumed. They are enduring, no? So, fast moving consumer goods, FMCG and consumer durables. Now, in these companies, essentially, it's clear that competition is very high. So, people who are really directly involved is the sales and production people. But does it mean that the others are less important? No, they are not. See, analogy often given is the human body. So, I ask you, what is the most important? Tell me, what is your view, human body? Human being, which is the most important organ or part? Anyone? All. Now you know the answer because I told you. But often you will have people saying, you know, brains are more important because the human being is differentiated from animals because they have brain, they can think. Animals are doing by instinct, whereas human beings are thinking. But then someone says the heart is more important because you can't think if you are dead. No. If the heart stops beating, you are dead immediately and so on. Then someone says it depends on the situation. Say that you are being chased by a tiger who is going to eat you up. Then your lungs are more important, how much stamina you have, and your legs, how fast you can run. So the debate goes on. So the answer really is, each are equally important, but depending on the situation, sometimes one part or organ or one department assumes a little more importance in the eyes of the top management than the others in situations. If you have a situation where the company is losing money, okay, and you have to immediately curtail the expenditure. So, which are the departments then at that time who control expenditure? Accounts and finance. So, to top management, they become very important at that time. But when market is growing, who is becoming important? Sales and production, because you are losing business. If you cannot produce, market is growing, you can get the orders. Production usually becomes more important because sales can get the orders, it is not that difficult. Market is growing. But production can't be, you are losing because you cannot deliver, or orders are being given by clients, but you have to deliver it. So, you have to expand the capacity, you have to produce. So, that is where production becomes. So, when you select which department of a company you will go into, you can select whichever you like. All are equally important. But then some people say, you see, there is always, life is not simple, there are always ifs and buts. Some people say, if you are in a business, then you should be in a department which generally is a money earning department, because business is all about money. So, those who earn money and those who understand the marketplace, that is the sales people and marketing people, ultimately they will go to the top. Because R&D may be very important, but they don't understand business, they understand technical things. Some people do that reasoning. But my advice is, whichever you think you are good at and you enjoy doing, you join that department. And if it's a good organization, they will see how well you are doing in your existing. And if you have got inclination and abilities for doing general business, general management, then they'll pick you out and they'll train you. Okay? So, economy you cannot get away from. Therefore, objectives of HRP is ensure adequate supply of manpower as and when required. Ensure proper use of existing human resources in the organization. Forecast future requirement of human resources with different levels of skills. So, this brings in a objective that management expects the HR department to be proactive. They are to forecast requirements. Now, in order for them to forecast, they require some inputs, right? So, they require inputs from the departments, operating departments, they require inputs from the top management of the company of what is the direction in which the company is going to grow. Unless they know that, how can they plan? Then assess surplus or shortage, if any, human resources available and available over a specific time period that they assess. Then another objective is anticipate the impact of technology on job and requirements for human resources. So, before the computer came and the IT came, we used to take more manpower, isn't it, to do the job. Even in the factory, when there were no CNC machines, we had manually operated machines. Their productivity, their production worthiness was lower. When computers came in, robots came in. So, that is the impact of technology. So, you have to anticipate that. Now, in the educational field also, you have to anticipate how technology will affect, and accordingly the manpower will have to be planned. What do you think will impact education field? What technology? Educational technology. Where are we sitting right now? We are sitting in the Center for Educational Technology. Now, we are recording the lecture. These lectures can be sent to various people. They don't have to come and sit in this classroom. What is the next step? We need not even record, or even if you record, the technology will make it possible to beam this to various other cities. If you have a receiving equipment put there, and people can be sitting in class at this time anywhere in the world, if you hook up and beam these lectures real time, isn't it? So, you can then teach more students with less professors. So, you can anticipate that technology, the requirement of human resources in terms of number of professors may reduce. Right now, ministry, if they tell us you are having 4,000 students now in IIT, you must have 8,000 students. Immediately, we think we should double the number of faculty. Because there is a limit, we say, to the classes. Beyond a certain number of students, it's not efficient, the learning process and the teaching process. So, we have to make sections. Each section means two professors instead of one. Now, you see how the technology is going to compress it. One professor can efficiently teach hundreds, maybe thousands of people distributed over different centers. So, the impact of technology is very, very immense, is vast. This has to be anticipated. But what is the general direction that technology is taking us with relation to manpower? What is the general direction? Is it reducing the employment and jobs? No. Why? Look at the machines on your shop floor. The CNC machine works so fast, All right, the machining centers, multi-turret presses, they work so fast now, their entire shift you can eliminate. But you are saying that it doesn't eliminate job? What views on this? You are all engineers. You have a nagging doubt that it doesn't actually eliminate jobs, but you don't know why, is it? It creates more jobs, but in different areas. You have to retrain the people. Okay. So, if you, in your factory, you had a press shop with manual presses and there were 20 presses and you are working two shifts. You have a CNC machine which can make you work, all right, with one machine in one shift and it can produce the same amount of job. So, you will have a lot of people who are surplus in inverted commas. But they won't be surplus because the CNC, programming of the CNC, all right, you can retrain those people. You need not have a highly qualified engineer because these are simple programming. You can teach, you can remove, you can retrain them for sales because you can produce more. You can retrain people. So, that is where the HR role comes in. Redeployment with retraining. And history has shown that it creates large number of other ventures. For instance, it throws up new types. For instance, technicians who are recording this category was not there 50 years ago, right? Because technology was not there. But another category which was there is extinct now. What is that? Draftsman. Do you find any draftsman in any office? 50 years ago, any engineering office, you will have huge drawing boards, you know, department, all draftsmen there, junior draftsmen, senior draftsmen, whole career there doing drafting. Nowadays you don't have. Does it mean there's less jobs? No. If you look at the macro indicators, jobs are growing. So, although this is a kind of paradox, although it appears that technology is reducing jobs, and it is immediately in the short run. In the long run, it is creating more jobs. So, control human resources already deployed in the organization. That means what? How do you control? What do you mean? If they are already deployed, like draftsmen, okay, or when we had computers, which when it first came in 40, 45, 50 years ago, what was the computer in every organization? Huge mainframe, we used to call it mainframe computers. You had air conditioned, you know, block, and it was like a temple. You had to remove your shoes, whisper in soft voices and go in. Computer Baba, computer. Nowadays, what is computer? It's lying around, you know, strewn around. A laptop, you're carrying it. Many of them are more powerful than your computers which you had, huge box. That all of us know. It has become miniaturized and the computing power has expanded. So, distributed processing has become order of the day, right? In those days, all the factories, union agreements, we used to have computer operator was one category. That means, they came and they only operated computer, they didn't do anything else. No one else operated computer. You wanted anything to be fed into the computer, you will send it to the computer operation department. From each department of the factory, they will feed it in, all right, they will only operate the computer. That concept is gone today. In whole of this institution, we have so much computing power, no, in IIT. Do you have any computer center where you send things? No, we all compute here. So, what has happened to the computer operator category? Is extinct species, but are they extinct? No, they have been retrained. They are being used elsewhere. But say you did not do that, then what would happen? Then they will sit there, and this is what he is trying to point out. Control the human resources already deployed. They would be earning their wages and salary doing no work because everyone is doing their work on PCs. So, you have to redeploy. You have to constantly see, monitor that with the change of technology or with the change of the business of the company, The products they were selling, they are no longer selling. Has there been any change in the type of work? And if so, what is the deployment of the people? That control you have to do. And that is done by HRP. Provide lead time available to select and train the required additional human resource over a period of time. The ultimate objective is to relate future human resources to future enterprise needs so as to maximize the future return on investment in human resources. Investment in human resources is personnel related cost, that's another way. Each company in their annual report sometimes would give a pie chart, you know, a kind of pie chart. And then they'll say, personnel related expenses. Then they'll say materials used, okay? These are all the costs, okay? Then these are overheads and various other elements of cost. And this has to be studied to see that this remains a percentage which is commensurate with the type of business you are in and the type of products that you make. So, the paradox often is that even with growing unemployment, there has been shortage of human resources with the required skills. This we hear again and again, no? On the one hand, we have large quantity of people, but when we want to hire someone, we don't seem to find the right person to fit into our kind of job. And large numbers of employees who retire, die, leave organizations or become incapacitated because of physical and mental ailments need to be replaced by new employees. Human resource planning ensures smooth supply of workers without interruption. And human resource planning is also essential to replace workforce turnover. Turnover means people separating from the company, leaving the company for whatever reason. These cause a constant ebb and flow in the workforce in many organizations. Technological changes and globalization usher in change in methods of production, distribution, and servicing of goods and products. What we are talking about, change in the method. These changes may require change of skills, that's why you say you have to redeploy and retrain, as well as a change in the number of employees. We discussed this. HRP helps management to adjust and cope with such changes. If you have questions, please interrupt me, ask your question. Ebb means ebb and flow. That is something, if you stand on a seashore, you will find that the tide goes out. After so many hours, then the water comes in again. That is the ebb and flow. Okay. Reduction and increase. Then HRP, of course, is required to meet the needs of expansion and diversification of the organization. Say you want to diversify into a new business. Immediately, HRP's role is very important because you have to hire that new skill which has never been there in the organization before. Okay. Identifies areas of surplus personnel and also areas where there are shortage of people. Steps can then be taken to redeploy and or recruit or downsize. Downsize means what? Give VRS or ask people to go. That is reduce the people, downsizing. Manpower planning vis-a-vis human resource planning. Now they are making a distinction between these two terms, manpower planning and human resource planning. HRP, which is human resource planning, concentrates on the developmental aspect of the employee, apart from the traditional activities of manpower planning, that is MP, like manpower forecasting, job analysis, career path training, etc. It addresses the human and the humane side of people to unleash the potential productivity and performance by promoting job satisfaction, organization commitment, self-development, etc., all of which contribute to the overall performance and well-being of the organization. Now, are you able to see the distinction they are making between HRP and MP or not? Can you see the distinction? Is it clear? To nobody. No one. All right. So, HRP concentrates on development. Development of whom? The people. They are focusing on the people as individuals and also groups. Whereas, MP does what? It focuses on numbers and types. Now, you see the difference? If I focus on you as person, but I focus you as a type and number, that is mechanical engineering, all right, number, roll number so and so, all right, type mechanical engineer, postgraduate thermal, but I focus on you as a person, name so and so, staying in this hostel, these are the kind of developmental needs, all right, requires to attend a course on human resource, because never had that before. I am concentrating on the human being and not on the number. Now, is it clear? Huh? So, the planning is twofold, HR planning. This is the concept being introduced. It plans at macro level of how many people, of what qualification, what type, in which department and when, what and when we said. But having the people already there with you, it also plans what is the kind of jobs they are likely to get into, what is the kind of training they require in order to grow and so on. So, sometimes that is called the HRD, human resources development. So, that is the distinction being made. It addresses human and humane side of the people to unleash the potential productivity and performance by promoting job satisfaction, that is motivating the people how to do it. Organizational commitment, that is building a culture where people are very happy to be working with that organization, like happy to be working with Tata's or Larsen & Toubro, commitment to the organization. Self-development, happy that they have got the opportunity to learn about more computer usage, because these facilities are available, to attend few courses, training courses, to learn more instead of just what they learnt when they joined the organization, to develop. So, that is the aspect which HRP, all right, addresses. Then, factors affecting HRP, type and strategy of the organization. Organizational growth cycles and planning, environmental uncertainties, time horizons, type and quality of forecasting information, nature of jobs being filled, offloading the work. Everything is clear? All these factors, they affect human resource planning. All clear? Time horizon. When do we require? Remember, we said planning was what and when. Remember that? So, horizon is when. We said what and when. Horizon is something which is far off. So, you require it in longer time. Any other questions? Okay. So now we will take a 5-minute break.